All right, folks, we're going to get started on our last panel. If the panelists could join us up at the podium. Originally, it was just going to be presentations, and I was like, we got too many people. We need to set up actual conversations and like give people prompts.
Yeah.
So,
great.
All right, everyone, thank you so much for sticking with us or rejoining us at the end of today. A really incredibly rich set of conversations. This is our last panel on Black healing and Black futures, and I'm going to hand it over to our incredible chair, Professor Nikki Jones.
Oh, thank you. Yes, 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 yes. The last panel of the day, I have to say, someone just asked me how I'm doing, and there were parts of the day when I'm like, oh, my back hurts, I'm feeling tired, right? Eula knows you were there, all right? But I come into every time the Black Studies Collaboratory curates a space and I enter into it. My spirit feels lighter, right? I feel like engaged, things start firing up here. Feel so proud of the work that my colleagues do. See the entire department, right, and campus and the community being transformed by this work. So thank you for asking me to be here to be a part of the conversation, and thanks to our panelists for being here today as well. So we're going to start. We have four panelists. Did everyone? I'm like, okay, and the rollout crew got it. I'm like, who is that? The rollout crew. Okay, and so we have Melissa Charles, Aya De Leon, Caleb Dawson, and the rollout crew, and reelaviolette Botts Ward, who are here today. We will start to my left with you, Ree.
Peace, family. So good to see everyone. I have a video I'm going to play. Again, I'm reelaviolette Botts Ward. I want to... Thank you, Rashad. Thank you, Rashad. Appreciate you. I'm filing my dissertation on Sunday, so yes, soon to be, doctor. Thank you, Rashad. Before I share my work, I just want to thank my mom so much for being here. Shout out to my mommy. And, you know, my mom has really inspired a lot of the work that I do around Black women's healing spaces. And I'm really invested in accessibility because I really do want my mom to be able to experience my work. So I'm dedicating my presentation to you, Mommy. And thank you so much for coming.
Peace, family. Yeah. I'm so excited to share with you my Black Studies Collaboratory project entitled The Mourning My Inner Black Girl Child Healing Project, brought to you by Black Women Healing and two of our wonderful community members, Brittany Tanner of Soul Development and Heather Archer. This project was all about offering tangible healing tools to everyday Black women. It's inspired by Mourning My Inner Black Girl Child, which is my first book. And the idea was that we would offer a book club healing circle to Black women, and we would offer these online virtual digital rituals that would allow folks who are reading this book to have healing tools to go alongside the poems and the healing offerings in the text. The other thought was that we would create an album for the book, and we had a lot of fun making songs and guided meditations and recording some of the poems from the book, and the album should be out in a year or so, fingers crossed. I had the pleasure of recording songs that I wrote for the first time. This was a brand new experience for me, and it was really beautiful and really heartening. And so what we've done is gone into these virtual rituals and incorporated Brittany Tanner's voice and Heather Archer on the sound bowls, and the songs that I wrote being sung and played with them in harmony. So I'll play the first one that you meet when you arrive at the digital virtual rituals. This one is called Denial. And the words are, you tell yourself a story, love. You tell yourself a story, love. Each of these click into a different ritual, and each section is one of the sections from the book. So this is the first full ritual. This is the second song that I wrote that Brittany and Heather collaborated on. And the words are, I thought some part of me had died. Part I thought had to die was longing for love on the inside.
I thought some part of me had to die. Some part of me on the inside. I thought some part of me had to die. But now I know. Now I know, but now I know, now I know.
And there is also a link to our SoundCloud where all of the songs and the guided meditations are offered. So for example, the ritual.
I invite you now to take a deep breath.
Into these guided meditations that are accompanied by sound bowls as well. So I hope that you all will experience these for yourself. Go to blackwomenhealing.com/book and it will take you to this virtual experience, and you can also find more on our SoundCloud. Thank you so much to the Black Studies Collaboratory for the funding to create this album and these healing ritual tools. Much gratitude. Peace, family.
Thank you.
Thank you. Melissa? Yes. Yeah, we're gonna do the YouTube video.
Let me go back to Chrome.
This one right here.
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. So that's a minute. Hi everyone, peace. My name is Melissa Charles. I use she, her pronouns. I'm the current assistant director for African American Student Development. I am woefully underprepared. Also, shout out to Rhea, someone who has both experienced and witnessed my students' experience, selfology, just all of the praise and all of the healing that happens, and that is amazing. So I am a proud, non-tenured PhD member of this community. And I can speak a little more to that. I think I came in a little late, so I might be reiterating things that have already been shared, but in the origin and in the tradition of Black studies, what I see, right, is revolution, and what I see is the ongoing struggle of folks who identify themselves as revolutionaries. I identify myself as revolutionary, as the great late Chairman Fred Hampton has given me permission to do so. And seeing the ways in which that really has grounded what's happening here, in that you can't say Black studies without talking about Merritt College. You can't say Black studies without talking about the Black Panther Party, without uplifting the names of Huey P. Newton and Bobby Seale, who, despite, you know, their issues, contributed a lot as far as the material growth and the ongoing material growth for our community. So a lot of what my project is about recognizing the origin of Black studies and its revolutionary initiative, and also seeing the process of building revolution as a scientific one, as one that we can learn from, and as one that we can continue to enact in our day-to-day lives, and particularly looking at organizations mostly across the state, but have been fortunate enough to be able to connect with organizations nationwide and some internationally, who are doing the work of building programs for decolonization, formerly referred to as survival programs. Some folks still refer to them as survival programs. Some folks have kind of evolved the terminology into building programs for decolonization with the ultimate purpose of allowing Black folks to live within self-determined communities. Folks have different ideas of what that looks like. That's where you start to get into some ideology wars. But ultimately, right, I think the shared goal that many of these different organizations that I see, that I work with have, is that we want to build spaces for Black people to own land, to build communities, build nations in some cases, particularly folks who are working to this day to build the Republic of New Africa, where we can create for ourselves. And so a lot of what my initial proposal was about was speaking to the necessity of political education within this process. So in order to actually get Black folks to a place where they're like, we trying to work to build our own communities, there needs to be the political education of an understanding of a shared identity, of a shared sense of nationhood, whether you're identifying as African, Black, or New African, as some folks identify as. And so a lot of the core of that work lies in politically educating folks about the true nature of their history. If we refer to the fifth point of the Black Panther Party, Party's 10-point program, and more recently, a mentor of mine, a former political prisoner, Jalil Muntakim, in his book, We Are Our Own Liberators, refers to a three-step process towards revolution, where the first process is building class consciousness and building unity through class consciousness. And so in developing curriculum around this, a lot of what my work was one, identifying organizations to this day who are on the ground, in the city of Oakland, in the city of Sacramento, in the IE, which to this day I still don't really know where that's at. If anyone does, please let me know. But I've heard it so many times. I'm like, y'all doing something over there. In the Hudson Valley in New York, in the Bronx in New York, in Detroit, Michigan, and in Cambridge at Harvard, actually, more recently. And so these are all folks who have really dedicated themselves to this ideology and are moving their organizations forward in this way. And being able to build out, one, a curriculum that allows folks to understand and study the origins of the Black Panther Party, but also study revolution as a concept, right? And so through this curriculum, we bring in the, I think someone here mentioned earlier, PAIGC, but we bring in these different revolutionary moments in our history that have happened, and we spend time analyzing them through the lens of dialectical materialism, through the lens of scientific socialism, to get a clear understanding on what these organizations were doing, where they failed, where they succeeded, right? And yeah, that's essentially the class. Was able to build out a class and really kind of work through that, bring in the work of Thomas Sankara, bring in the work of Kwame Nkrumah, bring in the work of Amilcar Cabral, Walter Rodney, obviously Malcolm X, Alhaj Malik al-Shabazz, obviously the Black Panther Party and the Black Liberation Army. There are so many lessons to learn within that whole movement. Me being of Haitian descent, I obviously was gonna bring in the OG Haitian Revolution and do a clear analysis of what happened from chattel slavery to revolution to where we are now, which is neoliberalism and neocolonialism. And in doing this project and in getting to connect with many educators across the state of California, was able to begin to build out a new educational tool is what we see it. We see it as political education, which is a docuseries which highlights the living legacy of the Black Panther Party. And so what are the organizations, who are the people and the individuals who are continuing this work today? What are their stories? What are they grounded in? How can you get into contact with them to actually be on the ground doing this work? And so we have been able to put out one episode. We've been able to screen it. We are about to share it at a conference in November, particularly for teachers alongside a curriculum so that teachers can begin to think about how they're implementing this docuseries into their classrooms alongside lessons or alongside activities, so on and so forth. And so what I have to share with you with my last minute, I don't know, I haven't been keeping track of time, is a little bit of our trailer. And yeah, this is one of the earlier ones. So that's just a snippet. We had the opportunity to speak with about five different organizations and bodies for that first episode. It's pretty dope, if I do say so myself. And yeah, looking forward to sharing more and talking a little bit more about what this experience was like. Thank y'all.
Perfect. I'm wearing one of Jill Christina's shirts from the Women of the Black Panther Party Project from the West Oakland Mural Project. So that was amazing. Thank you to all the folks on the panel and all the folks who have been part of this cohort. It's really amazing work. My name is Aya de Leon. Oh, thank you. My name is Aya de Leon. I am the director of poetry for the people and a lecturer in African American studies. Thank you. Currently teaching spoken word. My pronouns are she, her, ella, and my project was Black Literature Versus the Climate Emergency, which was an online conference that went up on YouTube in April of this year. And the vision was about using all different kinds of literature to fight the climate crisis with a vision of actually making the kinds of global transformations we need to make in order to win. This is the visual, one of the many things that the Black Studies Collaboratory money went to. I commissioned it, and this was our logo, and it's going on to have an additional life. Mostly the funds went for that and for artists' fees for the conference. I'll leave this where people can see it. Great. And so I'm a climate novelist. And that space is largely white, and you know, to the degree that there are people of color, they are mostly non-Black folks. So that's one part of my climate activism life. And the other part of my climate activism life is I organize with the Black Hive, which is the climate and environmental justice formation of the Movement for Black Lives. And as you can imagine, there's a big focus there on big policy changes, as well as disaster response, environmental justice, and the Black Hive is getting ready to send a delegation to COP in Egypt this year. But as one of my colleagues there, Tamara Tolles O'Loughlin, says,
You know, you can do policy all day, but culture eats policy for breakfast. So for me, it's been really important to think about how to make cultural interventions. And even though the climate movement, or certainly what we see of it, is largely white, although Black folks worldwide are hit first and worst, and it is the willingness of our societies to sacrifice Black people that has allowed the climate crisis to even get as out of control as it is now. And when there are gatherings or panels, et cetera, having to do with climate, let alone climate writing, they're often either all white or there's like one lone person of color. And so for me, I was really interested in finding a way to pull together different people of African heritage who are working in that space of writing to have conversations with each other. So we had a set of conversations in nonfiction, fiction, and poetry. I was really excited about how they came out. You can see all of this on YouTube, and I do believe that the link is available on the BSC website. And I wanted us to get a chance to dream and vision together and to connect. And some of the unexpected outcomes were the moderator for the nonfiction conversation was one of the staff people in the Movement for Black Lives. And she was in conversation with, among other folks, Vanessa Nakate, who is a climate activist on the continent. And one of the things that unexpectedly came out of that was that the Movement for Black Lives really wants to fund activists on the African continent to get to the COP gathering. So that was really sort of rich and unexpected. Another really rich and unexpected outcome of the fiction panel for me, I was on that panel with Maya Lilly and Tori Stevens of the online magazine Grist and Fix. And we were talking about really wanting to make an intervention in what's known as climate fiction. Many of us are familiar with the brilliance of Octavia Butler's 1993 book, Parable of the Sower, right? Completely looking at climate, among other things, and predicting our times, talking about this sort of dystopian fiction. But what was revolutionary in 1993 may not be the same revolutionary vision that's needed in 2022, right? And so right now, the climate fiction conversation is dominated by dystopia. And these novels that take place 10, 20, 100 years in the future all presuppose that we lose the fight that we're in right now. And I have decided as an activist that there's some way that conversation now is ceding too much ground. So one of the things that came out of this visioning session for me is I've decided to found a climate justice fiction imprint, which is looking for novels about that are similar to the novels that I write, which are about Black women going about their business, getting hit by the climate crisis, and deciding, I need to fight. We need to fight. And so that's what I've begun. It's called Fighting Chance Books, and it's an imprint of She Writes Press, although it's open to fiction, novels for adults by authors of all genders. And the vision here is really about expanding the climate fiction conversation, not just dystopias, but stories about winning. Because one thing that we know as Black folks is we are the way out of no way people. And we have to begin by speaking it and claiming it and envisioning it. And so one of the things that I really am here as a climate activist to say to everybody in the room is there is a rumor going around that it is too late. And the truth is that it's actually not too late for us to save the planet and for us to save our species. But it's going to require that we fight. And like, folks have been talking about, it may require that we do some very serious fighting around capitalism, around the way that resources and everything is organized globally. We got some fights around colonization and neocolonialism. There are big, big fights. But given all that's at stake, there are big, big possibilities to build those movements. So I am, and if anyone is writing a novel or is interested in writing a novel, I am taking pitches. I've got flyers on the table. So for me, it was incredible to get this grant from the Black Studies Collaboratory to kind of have this set of conversations that were as big as I could imagine, and coming out of that experience, being able to imagine something even bigger. So thank you all so much, and thank you to the Black Studies Collaboratory.
All right, Caleb and the rollout crew.
All right, everyone. Hello, hello. I'm glad to be here again. This is such a capacious initiative, the Black Studies Collaboratory. And when they put out the call for dream projects, I was like, I know something really dreamy that I want to see more support for, and that is Rollout Crew. So I'm really excited to be here with my friend Rashad and my friend Truck, who y'all will hear more from as we get into the Q&A. But Rollout Crew is organized and initiated by Truck. Truck is a longtime Oakland resident, born and raised. He is a minister and a funeral attendant or a funeral minister, a funeral officiant, a barber, he's coming out here tomorrow, an artist, and a leader of Rollout Crew. It all started with a bike ride in honor of his mom back in 2020. And the cool thing about Rollout Crew is it's multivalent. If you look us up on Instagram, which I encourage you to do, you'll see ROC all over the place. And that's because Rollout Crew could be ROC, but ROC could be also relationships, opportunities, and community. And those words also animate the group. And one way that I wrote here is, right, relationships, that the idea is that Rollout Crew is trying to build relationships and opportunities towards community, but there's so many ways to think about the relationship between opportunities and community. There are opportunities that haven't come from already having community. There are relationships that have built from certain opportunities, and it's just really bidirectional and multilateral. So something for you to know about about Rollout Crew is that it's a Black-led bike collective that has a purpose that's so much larger than bike rides. It's about community safety, youth leadership, and artistic development, combating violence through recreation, and with the conviction that community results from people having meaningful relationships and opportunities to build with one another. One of my favorite experiences as someone who regularly commutes to campus on my bike is that when I ride with Rollout Crew, we have a different experience of safety because we have large numbers and we're able to take up entire streets that usually feel really precarious because of the hustle and bustle of gentrifying Oakland. But together, we have a different experience of being with one another, of connecting across the bay, and I'm really excited for y'all to hear more from Chuck about what that's like. I'm really encouraging y'all to check us out on Instagram, Rollout Crew. I want to show quick, most of the next things that you'll see are pieces or just snippets from Instagram, because y'all can learn so much more from Instagram than this brief presentation. But I want to show y'all a quick video that Chuck took from one of the rides that you'll hear more about in a little bit.
Drums, please.
Here it is, a groove slightly transformed, just a bit of a break from the norm. Just a little something to break the monotony of all that hardcore dance that has gotten to be a little bit out of control. It's cool to dance, but what about a groove that soothes and moves romance? Give me a soft, subtle mix.
Come on, come on, come on. To hear more and see more, go to Instagram, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, Rollout Crew is one of the earliest crews that you might see out in the Bay. Now there's a lot, but Rollout Crew is not only one of the earliest, but really a model crew. A typical ride for Rollout Crew will start at West Oakland BART, and we'll head towards Berkeley, usually take a loop back to the lake and ride around there. It is by far the most family-friendly ride. There are times when we have kids with training wheels, or you're like, you should be using training wheels, and they're literally going like, yeah, miles cutting up through the East Bay with us. Parents No, literally, like there, it's really cool and precious to have an intergenerational experience moving through Oakland. As someone who can easily experience Berkeley as an all-encompassing place where that dominates most of my interactions, it's been so refreshing for me to get to kick it with people who are actually from the Bay, born and raised, and who are experiencing the area in a different way than I am. And that also tethers me to those experiences differently. One of the things I also love about Rollout Crew is Truck, because of his relationships, will often be called to bring Rollout Crew to different community events. Let's see if this is going. To different community events throughout the East Bay, especially in response to different forms of violence. And I think those are some of the most recent rides. This, on the right, you see the Black August block party just from August 27th that Rollout Crew was invited. And you'll on Instagram, you'll see, oh, Truck, hey, we need 20 to 100 bikes out, because people need to see our presence and feel the energy and the joy that comes with us being together and doing something on purpose through the community. Throughout the summer, we were also able to do a community birthday bike rides are a big thing. Like I said, it's really youth friendly and youth centered. In the second picture, you see that Truck was able to also, through some of the relationships that he has, get incredibly discounted bikes, and people also donate bikes for kids. Sonny is the one who received this bike. Sonny is often someone who, during the rides, would be like, hey, I'll sit this one out, I'll ride in the truck, because there's a truck that goes that also trails people to make sure that we have extra snacks, and that if someone gets tired, they can put their bike up and ride around. Sonny will often be someone who's like, hey, this person got a flat, they can ride my bike. And as someone just really generous, even on their birthday ride, was like, Truck was kind of low-key teasing him. He's like, hey, we had a kid, would you be able? He's like, yeah, I got it. The joke was, Truck ended up getting him a bike, a new bike. So this was a really big day. There's also the backpack giveaway and so much more. But yeah, Rollout Crew is a joy and a pleasure to be a part of. And I'm really excited for y'all to hear very soon more from Truck, who's been the one to initiate and organize and bring us together. Thank you.
All right, thank you. I think we have a couple of minutes for Q&A. Did we want to start with a question for Truck? I think some of us want to hear more from Truck, from Rashad. Yeah.
Check, mic check.
Man, how y'all doing, person? Yeah. I'm a minister and just got a little shy with a microphone in my hand. That's funny, yeah. Would y'all? I'm just
so do we have a question for the audience? If not, if you want to pick up on some of Caleb, yeah.
What I would like to say is thank you. Because what I do, I'm just now trying to organize my program or my organization so that I will be able to do more in a greater capacity and be able to offer children in the West Oakland 94607 or wherever the kids may come from, opportunity to be exposed to something different than what they have to see every day. The one thing I didn't get was a chance to be able to leave from my environment. So my environment shaped and molded me. It made me who I was. So the guy that y'all seeing on the slides is not who I used to be. And my goal is to help children not to become who I used to be. Reentry is a big deal in our city. You have people everywhere trying to focus on building people around reentry, and my focus is to reroute. I don't believe our children need to be come through reentry to have an opportunity to have the support. So I'm working on some stuff with some called creative wellness. I'm an artist, right? And I understand the importance of tapping into your creativity, what it does for an individual, when you discover what it is you can do by way of creating something in your mind and making it live with your hands, your feet, your mouth, what it does for an individual. Where I'm at, children don't often have a voice and an opportunity. Either you're going to be pretty, or you're going to be an athlete, or you're going to fall somewhere within there, right? And I want them to have their voice back. I want to give them the chance to choose and pick and learn and discover things outside of their environment. So your group actually helped me in a huge way to be able to take the children outside of West Oakland to expose them to different cities, different cultures, on field trips and allowing them to go in restaurants and sitting down and going over like etiquette before we take off and making sure they just know how to handle themselves. So just to see the impact, and I was trying to bring some today, but an emergency happened and I wasn't able to, but just to see the impact that it has had on their lives, because I don't have the money to do it. I don't have it. So what you guys gave to help me this summer was huge. So I want to say thank you. And my sister, I seen a lot of pictures from my neighborhood. I wish I'd have known I'd have had them pull up our Huey P. Newton bike ride and a whole bunch of other stuff. I want to connect with you, but thank you all for real.
For me, or so I actually want to invite the audience in. And so I think that where we're coming to with this panel is making me think about certainly transformation, transformation of the self, transformation of the story, transformation of the space, the streets, right, and the planet, right? And so I'm thinking about that and how each of you, so Truck just spoke to how the transformative experience for you and the work and the kids. But if you want to reflect on transformation, that's one question that I have. But I also want to open up the space for folks in the audience for either a question, a final question, or a comment for our panelists.
Well, I could say something. I mean, one of the things that I'm just struck by is how excited I am about, One of the things I'm excited about, I'm just struck by every single project. I'm like, yes, yes, yes. And how connected they are. And, mm-hmm. you know, one of the thoughts that I have about, you know, I work in climate because climate is one of those things that sits at the intersection of all these things, right? It sits at the intersection of racism, environment, land, but it also sits at the intersection of trauma, because part of why things have been able to get so out of control has to do with how much trauma the people have and how hard it is to try and figure out how to fight to take this on, the kinds of systematic attacks on the Black Panther Party and other revolutionary formations that were really saying, we can do this, we can fight. And then, you know, like, climate, bikes, it's like straight up, right? getting off fossil fuels, getting out of the cars, and the ways that it really transforms a space when we do that together, right? And I'm excited, you know, to get on my bike with y'all. But I just, in terms of your work, Ree, I can't stress enough how the impact of trauma on our politics. You know, and when we have these sort of strong men, violent men, political figures that rise, how triggered everybody is, and how frightened everybody is, and how, you know, reactivated everyone is around their trauma, and how much we shrink, and how much that working on trauma has to be part of our political work, part of what there wasn't quite enough of, right, back in the day with the Panthers. We have to have more of that trauma healing work, so that when backlash forces come for us, we're not as vulnerable emotionally, and can keep fighting and keep supporting each other, and it's harder to be splintered. And then, you know, just with biking, there's so many things that's good for the planet, but also good for the body, and how much in this work we need to be in our bodies.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
So my question is fairly simple. I'm curious to know, how exactly are y'all caring for yourselves, considering you are on the front lines doing this work? Thank you.
I could just share. Okay, there we go. So the album came about because I would go on my morning walk and I would sing to myself. Like, I just started singing to myself to soothe my spirit. And I thought creating an album, I really just wanted to make it for me because I love my homegirl's voice. And I was like, I want to hear her sing to me when I'm in my healing. So this project actually was an act of me caring for myself, and I've realized, like, I'm very grateful that I get to live a life where me doing what I do to care for myself can also support other people.
Yeah, I'll echo that. Is this on? Okay, cool. I'll echo that. I think that even in this project and getting to meet folks, what energizes me is being able to build intentional relationships with people. And speaking a little bit to that transformation piece, mm-hmm. right? I think a lot of folks, you will see Asada Shakur in her writing put it this way, it's R/E, revolutionary, evolutionary, and really understanding that this whole process is about evolution. So when I'm engaging with folks, when I'm engaging with the people, when I am doing free breakfast programs or grocery programs or working with youth on political education, like for me, that really fuels me and brings me a lot of joy. It also has forced me, right, in the scientific process of things, I came to the same conclusions as one of the things that we need to be doing better at as a community, which is when we are faced with COINTELPRO, right, when we are faced with internal ideological differences, how do we have a shared understanding of what accountability looks like? How do we have a shared understanding of what restorative or transformative justice looks like? And really, for a lot of what that comes back down to is how are folks responding when they are in a traumatized or triggered space? Mm-hmm. And how are folks engaging reactively? So that really has pushed me to bring that into a lot of these revolutionary spaces and to push revolutionary spaces to be more intentional about addressing these things. It also has pushed me to address these things within myself. So spending a lot more time in somatic practice spaces, doing my own healing, and then gaining that knowledge so that I can share it with folks who are on the ground doing this work as a central part of the work that they're doing. And just a note, right, I'm always thinking about things, is this bike piece. I recently started riding my bike to work on Thursdays. And it's been really interesting because I live in Oakland, and obviously I bike up here up Telegraph, and I notice that the bike ride up here is harder than the bike ride down. And it's just a really interesting for me.
That's
it's
a
really
metaphor.
Interesting. And it's not just because I'm coming into work and I'm dreading it, right? It's because there's a slight slope, right? And so when I start to think about climate change and when I start to think about which communities will most materially be impacted, right, by climate change, it's a very real reminder every Thursday when I'm driving back home and it's just a smooth ride down to Oakland that when the rain comes or when the mudslides come or when whatever comes, right, that we know which communities will be hit the hardest. And that's just a side note that I got while y'all are talking to bring us all back together.
I'll just say quickly, like, I have to cry a lot, y'all. Like, I just have to. And, you know, and I have a number of practices and peer counseling community and people I can just call and be like, I messed up today, and just let it out. Because I think, you know, our history as Black people, particularly Black women, was just you had to suck it up and keep going, right? And so for me, it's really revolutionary to, like, not do that, to stop and let it out. And, you know, for me, that's the way that I can get to the more authentic joy. And then the other thing that I just have to remember is, like, the future, you know, it looks scary, but it's not written yet. And every place where I am so certain, you know, every time, and I also don't read a lot of news, but, you know, stuff goes, oh, this is very, you know, and yeah, there's a lot of scary stuff out there, but what it triggers in me, and this is just part of what I talk about, what it triggers in us is those early places in our childhood, right? The early child work, those places where we were defeated, right? And we haven't done enough work to heal those early defeats. So when something looks, you know, It doesn't look hopeful on the horizon, we get really triggered into feeling like we're already defeated. So, you know, I've spent a lot of time mining those places in my early childhood where I felt like, oh, all is lost, right? And really grieving that so that I can be in the present with the fact that the future is not written yet and wanting to do everything I can to be part of writing it the way that we know it needs to be.
As for myself, I've been ordained 16 years. I've probably done over 800 funerals in the 16 years. I'm a barber also for the funeral home, so I see a lot of what goes on in the street, raw and naked. And I've taught myself how to escape. Sometimes when I leave the service, depending on how wild it is, I probably, although I'm the preacher, pastor, gospel is not the only music I like to listen to. my truck is set up to be extremely loud, and I can get on the freeway, and the last thing I'm gonna think about is the environment I just walked out of. A lot of people take their work home with them. I learned to leave it where it's at for my safety, right? And if it call me and it need me, then I can get up and I can make my way where I need to be, but I'm going to leave it there because if I'm no good, then I can't help, right? That's always my thing. And then I like to draw. So what I would do is, because I'm an artist, I will draw exactly how I feel. If I'm angry, I'm gonna draw it out, because in my mind I can see it clear. And it is so important when we, not just our youth, but every person, tap into whatever your niche is in reference to being creative. It is therapeutic. Too often it's being taught to be occupation or a job versus what it really is, and it is to help. So that is how I escape. I love to listen to music, and then I use what God gave me, and that's my ability to be able to draw out my thoughts.
I just want to add real quick, again, follow Rollout Crew on Instagram so that you know when the next ride is, so that you can
yes.
join us. Also, one thing that we're still going to do, now that the backpacks are out of the we're out of Truck's Barbershop, because there's a lot of school supplies there, we're going to kind of repaint it and whatnot. There's going to be a mural in honor of his mom, and a lot of kids are going to be able to help paint it. So there's more of this artistic work coming, more bike rides. So please follow so y'all can know when and how y'all can tap in.
Thank you. So let's say thank you to all of our panelists. Thank you. A wonderful way to end the day.
Thank you, Nikki, so much for moderating our last panel.
I always say this, but every time we have an event, Tiana and I look at each other and we're always amazed that an idea that we had on paper is filled with breath and air and genius mm-hmm. and care. So thank you. I know my heart is full of the kind of creative genius of your work about Black living under structures of injustice across and in the wake of colonialism and imperialism and slavery, but across the world, right? From Senegal to Namibia to Rwanda to Brazil to Chicago to North Carolina to Oakland to Sproul Plaza. This work has been incredible today. This grant is two of the principles of the Black Studies Collaboratory. One that you heard is about the world, amplifying the world building work of Black Studies, which I think we've seen in abundance today. Mm-hmm. But that world building requires dreaming. And we try to create the conditions where people can dream. And what I think we've seen today in all of the work that you've done is that even because in the urgency of the work, there's an impetus under capitalism to rush, right? But what you have all done is actually put breath back into this work, put breath back into Black living in many ways. You've slowed down, and we appreciate that. The second principle of this grant has been that that Black Studies is, that the university is not the only site where Black study and Black studies happen. And that we arrive at this place as much more than what our function in the university is, right? We come as artists, as dancers, and as bike riders, right? As organizers, but we also, I think importantly, we come tethered and bound to other people, to each other, right? And I think that's also what we've seen today, is that that our work has been in relation to community and to others. And I just want to thank you all, because you've renewed, I think, my faith or my commitment to this work, and just brought us together in a way that reminds us that collaboration is necessary for our survival.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you.